Welcome to All Things Financial with Jack Driscoll. Each week, Jack takes on all things you thought were hard to understand about your finances and makes it fun, easy, but most of all, interesting. From insurance to the best way to save your money and squeeze the most out of the dollars you put aside for your rainy day. And now, you have a friend in the money business. Here's your host, Jack Driscoll.
Welcome back again, everyone, to another edition of All Things Financial. For those of you on the radio and the TV, what I'm doing is sharing with you one of the workshops that I present to clients and others who are interested in these concepts of financial planning that I talk about on the radio and on TV. So I share with any one of you who are watching or listening to the show, if you'd like to attend one of our workshops, please feel free to get on our list and put a request into us that you'd like invited to the next workshop. We'll make sure you get an invitation on that. All right, so here comes the first of three parts. I've cut this into three parts this week, and the next 2 weeks will be a combination of the series of this workshop. What I put together here is a workshop mainly for year end, and we'll get started in that right away. You know my normal agenda on most of the financial planning is year-end tax planning strategies, but all year-long tax strategies. We go through estate planning, we go through tax planning, we go through anything at all, and then I'll end up with question and answers. But here are the major breakdowns on financial planning. The five key areas that I feel our most important categories. Protection. That's the one that I see most often missed. So most financial plans that I see are missing protection and they jump straight into investments. Protection means once we have a financial plan designed, we don't lose track of that we could lose it. How? Either taking too much market risk, market timing, tax risk, long-term care, nursing homes, auto insurance. You know, we have a case where, let's say, we're in an accident. We did everything else right in the financial plan. We forgot to protect our assets through insurance. Sometimes we're missing on life insurance where our dependents suffer because we didn't think protection. So I put protection first here. The second one is retirement planning. That's our long-range planning, and along with retirement planning, I put college planning inside there. I don't show it up here, but the reason I say retirement planning includes college planning is because for many of us, we're saving money for dual purposes. So we say, do I need a college fund and a retirement fund? Well, if we don't do it right, many times we're taking second mortgages out on our home to fund college, or the kids or grandkids are taking student loans to fund college, or we're drawing from our retirement plans or circumventing our own retirement planning, trying to help fund college. So I put that in here. It's a dual purpose. Then we get to investments. Everyone knows what that is. But investment planning deals with tax planning. So we merge those two, and you'll see why in this workshop and how that'll work near your end here. And the final is estate planning, and I'd like you to think of that as legacy planning. Estate planning typically was the avoidance of taxes, but estate planning includes legacy planning, where we might have a situation where our children are doing much better than we are financially, and we are looking at, where do we draw income in our retirement? And most people, or traditional thought is, we draw income from our least taxed assets, which are our non-IRAs in many cases, and we leave assets untouched, such as our traditional IRA assets. But in many cases, that's exactly reverse. When we look at legacy planning, we might say, we would have paid a 15% income tax on our IRAs as ordinary income unless we pushed into a higher bracket, where our kids might already be in the 28% bracket and they'll inherit those IRAs. It may be more tax efficient for us to draw income in some cases from our IRAs and hold our non-qualified assets for the kids to inherit, because they might enjoy the step up in cost basis and avoid tax entirely. There are a lot of strategies here in estate planning that include legacy planning. All right, let's start with the investments. Most of us have watched since 2008 and not realized we've been in a long, prolonged bull market. And when you look at the markets right now, you'll see markets are down. So we'll think, and most people I talk to say, markets are down, markets have not done well, the economy's still not doing well, et cetera, since 2008. But this chart indicates we're actually in the fourth longest bull market in 2015 until August. So as of August 11th, this was actually the fourth longest bull market in history. I don't think most people were aware of that. In 2010 and 11 and 12 and 13 and 14 and even in 15, that we were in that long of a prolonged bull market. So a lot of people missed the opportunity right there that was presented in a bull market. So I wanted to share that with you, because investing is sometimes a mystery. We don't know where we are in the market cycles. But market volatility returned after August 11th, and it returned with a bang, because this was only 1 week. This chart's here to show in just 1 week how fast markets changed. And you'll see here, the Dow plummeted on this chart, you'll see over 1,000 points in a week. So that's a huge move we had in a week. When this bull market came to an end, it came to an abrupt end. But what happened after that, look at the volatility on this chart, but in another week, you see the actual market reverse. So the market volatility was just as strong, but it was an upward volatility. But look at Monday and Tuesday of this week, the first 2 days of this week. Look at how much high volatility there was. In the first day, you'll see the market. It plunged 7% in 1 day on Monday here. And you could see that on the chart. And then skyrocketed back by Wednesday and overcame that. That's huge volatility we saw here. So when this market, the bull market, changed direction, it became highly volatile. It pretty much knocked us out of our comfort zone. And part of the reason why, we say, why do bull markets last? Why do they stop? Why do new bull markets begin? Why do bear markets begin? A lot of times it's external forces beyond our control. We saw Greece. We saw a lot of the economic problems overseas influencing our own markets. One of the main ones I put up here on the chart is China. China's growth rate is projected to be 7%. It was projected to be 8%. Our growth rate in the United States is 2% or less. Anyone who's on Social Security knows we did not get a Social Security CPI increase for 2016 because the growth rate, the CPI, is basically zero. So the national growth rate in the United States, we're only at about the 2% world on the national growth rate. Here's China at 7%, and it knocked our markets down. So it's interesting, because China has enjoyed over 8% growth rate for almost 20 years. So it's a real slowdown for a country like China to see 7%. And it actually started rocking our markets when we saw this. The other thing that caused some volatility was oil. We saw the rapid reduction in oil prices. And it happened fast. You saw, I don't know whether you noticed it while it was happening, but we've noticed it at the pumps. But we saw the natural gas prices come down. We saw them slow down drilling in the Dakotas. I mean, it's hurt a lot of the industries that deal with energy. And we've seen oil come down also. Oil was almost at $100, and it came down within a year to less than $50. That's a huge drop in 1 year. And yes, it did rock our markets. So that's some of why we're seeing volatility. The other is, most investors don't like uncertainty. And you'll see, when we get certainty, even if it's bad news, you'll see markets sometimes stabilize. And if it's good news, you'll see them take off sometimes on a bull market. But even bad news, you'll sometimes see markets stabilize. Uncertainty typically has had a tendency to make investors nervous. And what we saw in uncertainty here was with the Fed. Anyone who's striving for income right now from assets knows we basically have a low to no interest rate economy right now, artificially generated by the Fed to try to prop up the economy overall. But look at these rates. Everybody knows these rates, but these are what are causing our volatility. And the last thing I think that's causing our volatility, especially starting when we saw this market drop, was investor emotions. Investors are more worried now, I think, than probably prior to the Great Recession. So I'm getting a feeling of more uncertainty and fear now than I was getting before the Great Recession. And I didn't hear a lot of the rumbling as I am right now. So I know a lot of you are concerned, rightfully so. But don't forget market cycles like this and emotional cycles, because typically, you'll see on this chart up on top, we have euphoria in emotions when markets do well, but that's normally the time of the highest financial risk to invest. And what we see when the markets crash, like they did in 2008 and early 2009, that typically, looking back over history, has shown times of greatest financial opportunity. And most people miss all of that because of emotions. But I think that's what's happening today. I think there are uncertain emotions today on where the market's heading, where is the world heading, how uncertain it is, and is our money safe, and is it safe to invest? But this chart right here, to me, tells it all. Anyone who is comfortable that their money is trying to work over a long period of time, this is what the markets generically have done by the indexes. This is the Dow Jones Industrial Average historical market since 1976. And I think most of you looking at this right now would have to say, I'd take that. Look at the volatility, though. So it's only when we see the end game, the final result, looking back, that we're so confidently able to say, well, I'd take that. But boy, while you're in the middle of it, you look at the volatility in 2001 and 2008, and it's like the world is ending. And the majority, remember the emotional cycle, the majority of people get scared and say, I'm out of here. I can't afford to lose anymore, and miss out on all the opportunities of volatility. So there's risk with volatility, but sometimes we miss the opportunity of volatility shown on this chart. That's our real live Dow Jones Industrial Average chart. You'll see this in all the news, but when you look at this, Mario Gabelli, I don't know how many of you are familiar with him, but after an extremely volatile 2 weeks in September, he said he's largely ignoring the recent extreme market volatility, saying his investment horizon is 3 to 5 years, not 6 to 12 weeks. Folks, that's the key. Our people, and I have slides on this, but we look at this, that is the key, the time frame and the type of money and the purpose that you're looking for your money to work for you. Some people need safety of principle. Some people need growth on principle. Everybody's different. Some people need income. So everyone's different, and you choose accordingly. But if it's in markets, we're talking long time periods. Short time periods mean we're really trying to speculate, time the market, or gamble, all of which typically are destined to fail. Trying to time the market has not worked well for most people, including the best professionals. But this chart's here to show you, if you are in the markets, when you look here, a hypothetical growth, All examples I show in this workshop, by the way, are hypothetical, based on normal historical averages. But this one, hypothetical growth of $10,000 invested in this Standard & Poor's 500, the S&P 500, which we cannot invest directly in an index. But for illustrative purposes, $10,000 hypothetically invested in the S&P 500 from January 1980 to March 31st, 2015, you would have the first column there, $503,000 roughly in your account. So had you put $10,000 in the S&P 500 in January 1980, that's how much you'd theoretically have, $500,000, $500,000. If you try to market time along the way and just miss the five best days in the market over that 25 years, 35 years, you would only have $309,000. That move missing the five best days, and normally, or sometimes, the five best days are right off the bottom. So we're watching markets go down, and sometimes they bounce right off the bottom like you saw on those charts, and we'd miss the strong move but gain confidence maybe the markets are going up again. But if we miss just five of the best days, you'll see how much that, how expensive that mistake could have been. And then if we miss just the 10 best days over that period of time by not staying fully invested, it could have cost us conceivably where we'd only have $232,000 instead of $500,000 just by missing or trying to time the market. It doesn't work. Missing the best 30 days, we might only have $90,000. And missing the best 50 days, and again, we're talking over 35 years. That's not being out of the market for very much. We might only have less than 10% of the money we would have had just staying put. So the key to this chart is this. Anyone that you know, including your kids and including your grandkids, who you want to help grow money over a long period of time, you might want to teach general concepts to them about what long period of time means and not get tempted by trying to be smarter and just allow markets to do what markets have historically done. Even though we all know there's no guarantee markets will do in the future anything that they've historically done. So we can only use these as hypothetical rules of thumb. We do know one thing, markets will never repeat what they've done in the past. They'll always be different, but they might be somewhat consistent. We look at this 5 years later, after every single drop, after every single bear market, the biggest bear markets we've had, the Great Depression, a severe recession we had in the 80s. In the 90s, we saw markets go down. Some of you might not even notice that, especially in the bond markets, and in the Great Recession that we just had in 2008. With this, if someone stayed in, remember I said not to miss the five worst days, if someone stays in, what did it look like 5 years later, even after the worst of times? These are the types of returns people did, in essence, the markets did return with people that just stayed in it and said, oh, well, I guess we'll wait and see. And these were historical returns on those indexes. So we get to the question, are you investing or are you gambling? Are you an investor or are you a speculator? Knowledge is power. We look at Franklin Templeton. That was one of the greatest firms. If you look at Sir John Templeton, he basically founded Templeton, which merged later with Franklin. But they asked 1,000 investors whether the S&P 500 went up or down in the years 2009 and 2010. So I'll ask it to you, everyone, to think to yourselves or write down on a piece of paper that you have. I'll ask the question number one. Did the markets, what do you think, did they go up or down in 2009? And just write on your notes there, up, an arrow up or an arrow down for 2009. And then I want you to write, do you believe the markets went up or down in 2010. Franklin Templeton asked this question in a survey over 1,000 investors. And in fact, 66% of those surveyed thought the markets went down in 2009. And 49% felt the markets declined in 2010. In reality, the markets went up both years. Right after the Great Recession, which was the tail end of 2008, the index gained 26.5% in 2009 and another 15.1% in 2010. A lot of investors missed that market turn because they weren't sure what was going to happen. So the question for everyone is, and you'll see this on our signs sometimes, we put this up, are you a bull or a bear? Our sign outside of our office. What I want to do is have everyone consider revisiting your 2015 goals, because everything I showed up to this point is, where are we now? Are we in a bear market? Are we in a bull market? Are we not in the market? Should we be in the market? Should we keep our money safe? Everyone, I believe, needs to revisit your 2015 and maybe even overall plan now. Partly now because it's near the year end, so there are strategical reasons that you can take advantage of planning and changes made between now and the end of the year, and partly because the markets have gotten so volatile and things are in enough upheaval, it's a good time to reevaluate your personal needs, personal goals, how your money's positioned, and where you're trying to go in the future. Are the choices you made in the past still leading you there, or is it time to reevaluate? So we're looking at what the future will bring, and none of us know. But we do have some control over what we're doing. And one of the strategies that we use is considered called rebalancing. Now, what that sometimes means is different for everyone, but rebalancing can mean we in advance choose different categories of where we want our money positioned. So we might say we want some money here, some money there, some money elsewhere, some money invested, some money not invested, some money liquid. Whatever the percentage is, it's balancing. It's balancing our risks, it's balancing our gains, it's balancing our purpose for our money. Well, what we find sometimes are some of those choices we made do better than some of the other choices we made. And you'll find some of the categories, you might say, for example, I'll do 25% in four different buckets. And you might find one is excelling and the other is lagging. So you might, in a year, see your balances are out of whack. You started at 25% in four buckets. You might have one with 40% of your overall portfolio all in one bucket because it did so well. You might see 15% in another one of those buckets that started at 25 because it did poorly, or you were drawing from it for income and it didn't replenish. So we might get to a situation where we'd say, is it prudent for us to consider rebalancing those buckets from time to time? That's rebalancing. And that's the concept of rebalancing. It's not right for everyone, but it is right for some. All right, that's the end of our first part of a three-part series I'm airing over the TV and radio for all of you. We'll be back again next week with part two.
Securities and investment advisory services offered through Sage Point Financial Inc., member FINRA SIPC, and registered investment advisor. Insurance services offered through Driscoll Insurance and Financial Services Inc., which is not affiliated with Sage Point Financial Inc.